Chapter 15, Soledad Street, November 1st, 1998. Bob Mueller's offices commanded sweeping views of the San Francisco Bay Area. Huge shipping vessels glided over the bay surface toward the Golden Gate, the rooftops of Chinatown and Russian Hill. They were the kind of views you pay $1,000 a night for in a luxury hotel, and 6 months into this new job, Bob Mueller was getting paid to enjoy them every day. He'd made a lot more money at other times in his roller coaster career, private practice in Boston, and had been especially lucrative for the Princeton graduate. But his heart belonged here in the Justice Department, and 11 stories above the streets of San Francisco was not a bad place to be. It wasn't always that way. He grew up attending private schools in a wealthy Philadelphia suburb, did a decorated stint in Vietnam with the Marines, and in law school was groomed to make money. Thin, dark-haired, and tall, with a firm jaw and handsome, angular face, only the downward pull at the corners of his eyes softened his determined gaze and gave him a slight air of sorrow or worry or both. He started out with one of his big firms in San Francisco, working on the civil side, a former federal prosecutor once recalled in a radio interview. He got bored with that and came over to our office. When he got to our office, he worked on the civil side as well, and he got bored with that. And I still remember the day he walked into the criminal division and at that point didn't know where the men's room was, but he was a quick learner. Mueller discovered that he was, deep in his soul, a criminal prosecutor. He did what he thought was right, not what others thought made sense. And at one point, he gave up a multi-six-figure private practice to work homicides for the U.S. Attorney's Office in Washington, D.C. It shocked everyone that he, an attorney who in the Reagan years had been John Ashcroft's right-hand man, would consider such a downward move. But it paid off when his boss, Eric Holder, was appointed Deputy Attorney General during Janet Reno's reign. In the spring of 1998, Holder sent Mueller to run the U.S. Attorney's Office in San Francisco. It was a mess. Morale was in the gutter. Federal agents had lied and suborned perjury in court. And newspapers were reporting that a customs officer took kickbacks from an informant in a drug smuggling case. Prosecutors suffered the consequences of those transgressions when cases made it to court. The ex-Marine and Mueller took charge. According to one reporter, he had everyone reapply for their jobs. And he made it clear that the laid-back West Coast workplace would not be tolerated. Caseloads doubled, but efficiency increased. He shut off access to the press for anything that wasn't public record. With a reputation for being tough and incorruptible, he pulled together teams to step up investigations of white-collar crimes in Silicon Valley, then surprised everyone when he took an interest in violent gangs. No one in charge of the federal prosecutor's office, like Mueller, they usually came from the East Coast with plans to return, had ever cared about Northern California's unique problem of prison gangs running amok in little farm towns. The feds always left that stuff to the locals. But Bob was a rolled up sleeves kind of guy who dug into agents and Western Familiar reports with enthusiasm. He was a micromanager who liked to know the details lurking in his Northern District's files and every day would check in with the investigators on the most sensitive cases. To keep up with their data, he had a special software system designed and named it Alcatraz. FBI agents' 302 reports describing the work of a Nuestro Familia informant in Salinas were piling up. Where was this gang surveillance headed? A RICO case was the likeliest possibility, though it presented difficulties Mueller was all too familiar with. He tried and failed twice to prosecute a gang using RICO, the racketeering laws designed them to rein in the mafia. That was the Hell's Angels, and in the 1980s, Mueller lost two trials because he used gangsters as informants. His witnesses turned out to be as sleazy as the defendants, if not worse. They let these people off, people who were committing more crimes than the people they were trying, one juror complained about witnesses who'd been offered immunity. After two mistrials and a dismissal of all charges, even the Angels' leader, Sonny Barger, walked because the jury despised Mueller's informant so much. It was humiliating enough that the federal judge was outraged to hear a biker named Big Red say on the stand that he was paid $30,000 for testifying on top of another $30,000 he'd been paid while cooperating. An Angels defense lawyer seized on Red's words, charging that Mueller's team had bribed a witness. It came out in testimony that Big Red, a man who, as one writer put it, answers the door armed with a pistol and shoots spiders off the wall, may have only been doing his part as a citizen because he wanted the government's help in avoiding a murder rap. As Mueller's second attempt at the case came to a close, it was clear the defendants would again be acquitted. On the last morning of the Last Angels trial, Mueller had to stand in front of the judge and tell him, "The government's position is that there will be no retrial in this case." Gangs and informants came to represent a haunting phenomenon Mueller suffered only rarely in his career, failure. And that was his experience with a gang that operated in the open in the streets. The prison gang, Nuestra Familia, presented a truckload of brand new problems. It took years to rise into the gang's ranks, and violent crime was the required price of admission. It was impossible to infiltrate the NF using undercover agents unless you had a couple decades to spare and didn't mind your men going to prison and committing murders to make their bones. No, infiltration of the Familia by FBI agents was out of the question. He'd never faced an enemy such as this. Like suicide bombers, these men had nothing to lose. There were murders to demonstrate that point. One guy slain in an artichoke field, another gunned down outside his apartment in Salinas. The NF was an extremely close-knit organization whose street-level members were equally ruthless and unafraid of death, and whose leaders were already doing life in the harshest prison in the state. How do you knock down men who've already taken the toughest punches in your repertoire? An idea brewed and took hold among the men and women of Mueller's team. The NF controlled California's prisons, and through its support networks of wives, girlfriends, and Norteño soldiers, they also controlled the streets. What if the team used federal law to convict those leaders for conspiracy crimes under RICO and then scattered them across the federal prison system to Louisiana, New York, Florida, and Colorado? Such a tactic could crush their base in Pelican Bay and fling them far from homes, allies, families, and each other. It might work. Of course, Mueller would still need cooperating witnesses to testify in the trial phase. That kid Mo they had working in Salinas was pretty good, but he was low level and had no access to the leaders in Pelican Bay. Luring anyone from the top to defect seemed impossible. With the Italian Mafia, you could threaten the wealthy, comfortable, top brass with life in prison, and occasionally you'd flip a Sammy the Bull Gravano. But these criminals were already doing life in austere isolation cells. They didn't even fear death. It was maddening, and it was a challenge Mueller and his team could not let pass. Bobby Mueller was one of the most relentless guys I've ever met, a college roommate once said. Now, still vigorous, at 55 years old, Mueller did not hesitate before plunging ahead, beginning with the risky business of allowing FBI case agents to cultivate criminal informants inside the NF. As a veteran of the federal prosecutor's office in Boston, where the FBI's protection of Irish mob murderer Whitey Bulger was currently making scandalous headlines, he might have paused to reconsider. But the public didn't always understand the moral ambiguities the government straddled when trying to take down the mobsters of the world. Those notions did not slow Bob Mueller. That a few informants had lost their lives did not slow him either. When the key witness in the prosecution of Manuel Noriega died in a mysterious Miami car crash the night opening statements were delivered, Mueller was not deterred. So when the call came to embark on this quixotic adventure in California, Robert Swan Mueller III jumped on his horse and brandished his sword. Rico Wayne Garcia was also a man who would not be deterred, and his spirit returned the day after the crew's Halloween break. Screw the gang cops. The hits were back on. People were beginning to talk, disrespecting his men for not striking back, and the longer he waited to exact revenge, the worse it would get. The taunts reached the tipping point when Kermit overheard a no-good called Shorty publicly mocking Lobo's injuries, telling everyone he'd been shot in the nuts. Rico and Chente drowned their frustration with another homeboy inside the Harmony Bar as they discussed what to do. The next day, Rico went to Natividad and received the excellent news that Lobo was expected to make a full recovery. It had been touch and go because it was his guts, not his balls, that had taken the worst of the blast. Now he had a big old scar across his belly, and it sliced his tattoo of Salas right in half, leaving one side of the word several inches north of the other. The same way the San Andreas Fault was said to split mountain ranges and leave half in another county. The morning after the Cruz families went trick-or-treating, Spookio and his girl got into a fight. They were supposed to go out of town together, and when Spookio said he couldn't, she took off with their daughter. He, of course, wasn't allowed to explain to her why he couldn't go, and he was home sulking and kicking it with the homeboy when Rico called and informed him that Kermit was on his way. Rico and Chente had given Mo the day off. Kermit showed up at Spookio's pad with Chachi and a brand new mission. A new name had been added to their ambitious hit list, that loudmouth Shorty. They'd done the scouting that morning. Kermit and his girlfriend finally made up after their torturous fight 2 nights ago, which was convenient because his girl Laura happened to be friends with Shorty's girl. She and Kermit paid the couple a friendly visit in the morning. Shorty didn't hold back, telling Kermit that asshole Lobo was no good, and he was shocked because he had it coming. If you continue to hang around with these people, Chente and Rico, the same will happen to you, Shorty warned. Shorty told Kermit that Copas was running Salinas now. That was enough to substantiate the rumors that the fucker really had cracked those jokes about Lobo being shot in the nuts. The crew was obligated to set an example. Most important, the bosses insisted that Shorty be shot in the same part of his anatomy he had mocked in Lobo. Let me get this straight, Spookio told Kermit. They want me to whack him because he made fun of LB getting shot in the nuts? No, Kermit said, because he's threatening Carnales and spreading rumors and saying Copas is running Salas. That's why. Hold on, Spookio said. Let me get dressed.